Oh, this series of presentations are for us to awaken together. And a lot of that is about noticing together. The peculiarity here is that you see this flower off to the left of my head. Maybe it's actually reversed for you. And it's on my right, but it's a pink orchid on my desk behind me that is not being eliminated by the virtual background of the ocean here in palm tree in Hawaii or wherever this might be, this gift may be from. So these levels of reality, or imaginary reality, virtual reality, that are being constructed and reconstructed, that engage our awareness, which is more or less constant. And we'll get to in this exploration that is a shared experience to a place where we are able to see that the structure underneath awareness that holds it all together, holds this mirror-like, receptive, reflective awakeness, this quality of awareness that is imageless and choiceless that we all share as a groundless ground of our being. This absence that undergirds it is a void, which is a primordial. It hasn't been taken form. It is fundamental in that it is indivisible and spaceless and timeless. And so it can serve to unite space and time, energy and matter, mind and body, and serve as the witness. We're actually looking through being this immortal, uncaused, unborn, deathless void that is collecting and coalescing everything that is perceptual, actually, the dimensionless backbone of the entire cosmos is being united in each of us, as was said last time. And we can actually experience this. And when we do, all of our attention is captured and united with all of form, all that is imaginary and perceived that is changing. That which is unchanging, the absolute, and that which is relative are inseparable then, and there is a sense of well-being, a sense of peace, sense of being whole and complete and peaceful, full of peace, because everything is integrated together, and we feel self-aware, and we're able to share this quality of awareness by being aware of awareness and sharing conscious awareness consciously together by being conscious of it. And so these are the very basic rudiments of mutual understanding and empathy, being able to feel what each other feels and understand what each other understands without it being so complicated to express it in just the right words, and then still not feel fully understood and feel like we're just a separate individual with our own separate experiences that we're proud of, or that we unite and we gather together and hold as our personal identity, our self, and treasure it as our most precious belonging, if you will. And then wish to share that with someone that we trust absolutely to care about us and love us and who will fully receive and allow us to love them more or less uninterruptedly, and maybe give birth to children with a partner or adopt children. So the children are innocent, and they look to us for their for this same love and appreciation and acknowledgement and recognition. And we bring them up and feel this undivided unity with them, because they depend upon us, and we depend upon them for their for their unconditional love of us. And we feel this bond beyond our own self-isolating, egocentric, self-centric self. Now, we have the same situation with our new brain, this neocortex that has emerged out of our reptilian body, our sensory motor intelligence, and our emotional mammalian heartfelt neurophysiological psychology, which itself emerged out of the reptilian consciousness in order to be able to bring about more tribal collaboration between many more sentient awakening creatures. So this new brain is able to focus this formless awakeness, which is ever present, to hold this mirror up to all that we are, and receive and reflect upon it all, so that we learn from what we're unaware of. We can hold it in this imageless mirror, like we can see ourselves in the mirror in our bathroom. And we can say, oh, look at this, I'm aging, I have egg on my face, I'm looking cheerful or a little bit confused today, sad or pathetic or whatever it might be. And so we can honestly assess in this objectless, imageless mirror in the bathroom what our relative appearance and our physical and emotional and mental self appears to be like by our own assessment. So we need to be able to see clearly who and what we are. This is self-awareness. Damkai Norbu, the venerated Buddhist scholar that died just recently, that was honored around the world as one of the most foremost teachers of what is called Dzogchen, which is the Buddhist version of the bone tradition that goes back 18,000 years, apparently, in which we sit down and allow and accept everything to be exactly as it is. And by doing so, by not resisting and just seeing things clearly, we're able to untangle our unconscious and thereby receive it consciously in this mirror-like awakeness that they refer to as the pure and total presence of awakeness, which is one the only constant in the whole of consciousness that has an appearance at the relative level. So it is receptive and reflective because it is a byproduct of this indivisible void, this absence, which gives rise to our presence. So these are some of the ingredients. If we're going to make scrambled eggs or upside down pineapple shortcake or something, we need to have all the ingredients on hand in the right proportions. And if we're driving on the road, we want to have, especially in a downpour or a blizzard conditions, we need to have our windshield wipers working well to automatically clear the windscreen so we can see the road ahead of us as we drive, so that we don't drive off the road into something and get shipwrecked. Also, this clear seeing is a term that is used often. And some people talk about, you know, awakened consciousness or enlightened awareness. This one is very particularly interested in, you know, what is it, how nature has designed us to be able to be awake as one and many, where we are incomparably unique every moment, but we're incomparably unique together. And we can notice that by clearing the windshield automatically by being aware of awareness. So we go back to Dzogchen, Namkhai Norbu's great book that I highly suggest. It's available on Amazon. It's called Dzogchen, the self-perfected state. Okay. So the relative self is utilizing the absolute or absolute nature to perfect itself. And that is how we can feel, you know, good about who and what we are, because we're awake and aware of this relative self in a way that's honest and you know, open to how incomparably unique it is every moment, how it has anxieties and fears and wants and cravings and wishes and wants and preferences. And so we need to keep track of all of those and recognize, you know, it's nice to have all those preferences and wishes and wants and fears and you know, desires to avoid this or that, not get hung up on that, to just recognize that we have them. And by being fully conscious of all those facets of our mind, this mind-made version of who we are, this heartfelt version of who we are in this sensory motor reptilian eat-or-be-eaten version of what we are, that we can continue to be open to this communion of being this emotionally heartfelt, all-loving being that is essentially all-inclusive of all that is and everyone as equal and as an indivisible part of what we each are as an incomparably unique individual. So obviously this is very, very complex. And so that's why it's so important to keep our mirror clean, like we want our glasses to be clean or our eyes to be working properly, or clean the screen, our two-dimensional screen of our computer or phone. You call them not iPhones or Androids or whatever. So the screen needs to be clean. And so this goes back to thousands of years of the bone tradition and Buddhist traditions and Hindu traditions that we are, as Gautama Buddha said, there is no self. And so we can get to this point where we are the absence, which gives rise to this presence of awakeness that can embrace and hold all that we can feel and sense and perceive mentally, emotionally, and physically as an undivided whole, effortlessly and continuously or seamlessly. And we can collaborate on this because our combined awakeness and shared presence and all-loving communion as consciousness itself, as Eckhart Tolle would say, the joy of being is the joy of being consciousness. And so we just add the joy of being consciousness together is the joy of being. So we are moving rapidly towards this sense of a global enlightenment where actually the expansion of the universe is this void reuniting everything that forms out of it as space, time, energy, and matter, mind and body, fields and forces, reuniting and reuniting and reuniting in the whole of three-dimensionality, because three-dimensionality is made out of these dimensionless coordinate locations of that geometry, which are indivisible by being dimensionless. And that is the foundation of the observer, getting back to the witness and the awakeness that is, you know, can be become constant. Even when sleeping, one can be awake, independent of being identified with this body, heart, or mind as a human being, and be in this absolute bliss of pure and total consciousness that has no object. Some have called it and written about it and done PhD theses on the subject of consciousness without an object. Eckhart Tolle talks about thoughtless awareness, or the practice of presence, that as we begin to explore what it is to be present together and share this oneness, that we necessarily become teachers of presence. We need to, even if we don't say anything about it, we want to extend this sense of shared sensitivity, of present moment embodied awakeness as a human being with other human beings and creatures and bugs and life forms and trees and bushes and leaves and all life everywhere in the cosmos, which is very vast. It's probably, you know, by best count, trillions of galaxies with hundreds of billions of suns each, and probably trillions of planets, just like the Milky Way galaxy that we're in is by best count, you know, have tens of thousands of Earth-like planets and at least trillions of planets circling, you know, 100 to 200 billion suns. It's actually difficult to count them all because there, some of them are on the other side of a, whatever it is, it's a 51 billion solar mass, 51 times the mass of our small sun, our local star, 51 billion times the mass of our sun is located in the center of our galaxy and gravitationally holds all these 100 to 200 billion suns and all of their planets and the whole galaxy together as we're rotating at about 250,000 miles per hour as a solar system, all our planets revolving around the sun like a jellyfish being followed by its tendrils as it swims at 250,000 miles per hour, about two-thirds out from the center of the Milky Way, doing a circuit of the entire galaxy about every quarter million years. And we're actually falling towards the sun here on the Earth at about 1.2 million miles per hour, as I understand it. And actually sitting here seemingly still on the surface of the Earth, we're actually spinning at about 6,000 miles per hour as the Earth spins around its axis. So actually in quantum gravity is Dries de Witt and what's the other fellow's name up in Canada, who I highly admire, I just can't remember his name right now, who collaborated with Dries de Witt on a model of quantum gravity. And I think they really hit on something very, very key, that essentially every single elementary particle is an observer and makes measurements of what it's observing at a quantum mechanical level of its context. And this is the way it finds out, you know, where are the local and lesser and greater densities which it can clump with or interact with or share fields and forces with, because the more concentrated space-time becomes, the more it centralizes in as a singularity or as a particle-like phenomena, where there's really no particles, as has been said. They're just densities of field space. So if you take the entirety of the field of all that appears to be existing at the relative physics or physical level, naturally there's going to be a distribution of, like, where do all the marbles roll to? Well, there's, you know, how many photons or how many electrons and how many protons. These are the fundamental particles, and there are other particles that appear and disappear, you know, trillions of times a second, and don't last for very long. But they're part of this equilibrium of like the ocean waves going up and going down, and yet the ocean remains stable at an average surface level due to the gravity and the earth and all the other aspects that surround the ocean. The whole universe surrounding the earth. So the particles are, if you will, like a gravitational singularity, that are not only gravitational, but they are emitting, they're communicating indivisibly, instantaneously in the fourth dimension of space, which is just another 0D point, which all coordinate locations are dimensionless singularities, which are not divided from any other dimensionless singularity. So every coordinate location in the entire cosmos is instantaneously indivisible from every other location. And so at one level, every point is all points. And in the physics of it, every point in 3D in this relative universe shares a single, what's called a polar point in the fourth dimension of space. So you can imagine like everything uniting at the rising point of the rising sun. All light is emerging from the sun. So also is the gravitational force of the sun uniting all the planets and everything to that singular point of gravity at the center of the sun. And so that is also true of us. We are a singularity as a witness. Of course, we have countless zillions and gazillions and quadrillions of singularities throughout our body, heart, and mind, within every atom and molecule and cell in our bodies. And so we are like an antenna, one of these big mirror-like dish antennas that they have whole fields of them that are radio antennas or mirror-like antennas that they send out in space, like the Hubble Space Telescope, or here on the planet on Mauna Kea or whatever, that have all these adjustable mirrors. So we're like a telescope in that way. We adjust our sight and smell and hearing and feeling and sensing. And as an integrated whole, using all these dimensionless points to be resonant or synchronized or united as nowhere, as nothing, as no one, as the anatta, the no self, and therefore there is no separation between any two receptivities and reflectivities of this mirror-like awakeness that is choiceless and has no image of its own, like the mirror in our bathroom. So there's all this circuitous perceptual logic, if you will, the logic of the mind, the intelligence of our perceptual sensory knowing that is momentary, moment by moment by moment. We're unknowing what we thought we knew one moment before, to be opened and unlearn all of that so that we can relearn who and what we are as fresh and new each and every instant as it happens and unfolds to this timeless, immortal, unchanging, unborn being of a void-based nobodiness that is going nowhere forever and ever peacefully as the stillness that Eckhart Tolle has said would save the world. If we just become awake as the stillness, then our relative bodies, hearts, and minds that are undergoing all this fractionalization of appearing and disappearing and reappearing can all be anchored in this groundless ground of our being consistently and seamlessly together. And in this way, because this is happening more every moment as the universe accelerates in its expansion, because it is observing itself to be as it is. And by that act of observation, as it is for us, every particle measures itself to be more or less at rest in a structured system of particles with a thermal spectrum that is related to our rate of acceleration, like spinning on the surface of the Earth, changing direction in space over time, and as a result in quantum gravity, measuring ourselves to be more or less at rest in a structured system of particles, because we are accelerating through space-time. Talk about a complementarity of seeming opposites. So when we are actually spinning at 6,000 miles per hour right now on the surface of the Earth, we're actually appear to be standing still, or we appear to be somebody doing something, having unique experiences and feelings and thoughts about it, while at the same time, we're nobody going nowhere forever. So this complementarity of being form and formlessness joined together at the hip, inseparable, where what could be more opposite than form and formlessness? But they are, by you being united together, formlessness unites all form indivisibly and instantaneously, moment by moment, seamlessly, indivisibly. So we are indivisible individuals. We feel we have this natural integrity that we want to cultivate and get to know and learn about and become wise from knowing and being able to share and be able to share this wisdom with our tribe and with our beloveds and the ones that we care for and want to educate to, so they can come into this magnificent miracle and share it with others that they fall in love with and appreciate and admire and look up to and have other people look up to them, and so that so they can feel acknowledged and known for what they are discovering and their wisdom and so forth. And so there is this Indra's net, so-called. Have you ever heard of Indra's net? It's like one of those dance hall balls that spin, that have many, thousands of mirrors that have a different image received and reflected in it. And as it spins, it just keeps all the, what is received and reflected is changing constantly. We're like one of those in a way. And so like the axis of spin of a top that spins well and doesn't fall down, or a gyroscope that can help to stabilize a satellite, and especially you have three of them at orthogonal axes to each other, one up, one sideways, and one at catacorner. If you have three gyroscopes, like your body, heart, and mind, and my body, heart, and mind, and we can align the axis of our gyroscopes, we can share a common axis, which is bold as love, as Jimi Hendrix said. So there is this point of stability that in my 2014 paper that I presented at UC Berkeley at the first Foundations of Mind conference there, it was titled The Mapping the whole in every one. So we're kind of, that's a metaphor. We're like mapping the whole, the wholeness in every one of us. And it's also the hole, this black hole, this absence, which is uniting all of us, and this axis, which is dimensionless, around which everything can spin without any friction or resistance. So if the axis of the car wheel or the bicycle wheel or the axis of ourself was not dimensionless, we would be feeling all this friction. And in fact, when we are not dimensionless, well, we're not nobody going nowhere and as everybody going everywhere all the time. And we're able to balance the relative and the absolute, the timeless and the timely, as simultaneous occurrences, form and formlessness as inseparable, where formlessness is, we're conscious of formlessness, making form inseparable and indivisible, and form making formlessness into this awakeness, this indivisible consciousness that is the unity and joy of our being, all that we are as sensory, emotional, and mental phenomena, and as spirited, soulful, immortal, you know, freedom from death, freedom from fear, freedom from worry, and so that we're all powerful co-creators and recreators of creation, that creation made us to be, creation made us in its own image to be recreators of creation, to be creative sources of that make all that is fresh and new every moment. How amazing are we? Goodness. And like the same way we have trillions of about 50 trillion human cells collaborating together and 10 to 20 times as many bacterial cells all collaborating together to create this sense of being a single consciousness here. I'm getting a fade on the screen because the light is coming in above here. What to do about that? I don't think there's any way to extend this. Yes, there might be. Move back. And I'll do this. There we go. Very good. I can still see the the orchid appearing off of this ear over here. See that? Like having a flower in my ear, like a flower child. So I'm just putting this all out there as a mishmash of aspects that are all always happening. And if we don't know that all of these things are happening simultaneously, and we just think there's just me and my stuff and what I want and what I don't want and what I have and what I don't have, then we're very, you know, very constricted, and we're not going to be very happy with that. We're going to keep reaching for, you know, more physical relative stuff like money or emotional conquests, having a large audience or, you know, patronage or something, which I don't, the reason I care about us being awakening together is because there is only one of us, and there's really nothing else left to do except to you know, go to the beach and, you know, go surfing, body surfing in the beautiful warm water, or freezing cold water on the East Coast of the United States, where I grew up. And just play. This is the play of Leela, the play of form and formlessness. It's being an individual who is indivisible from everyone and everything, as Carl Jung has said, that, you know, in the process of maturation, paraphrasing him, the individual eventually realizes that they're indivisible from everyone and everything. And when more of us realize this, we have a chance of having a conscious civilization on this planet. So Carl Jung was very aware of the collective unconscious and the individual, what it took for an individual to be awakened to who and what they are as indivisible and individuating. So this is a very essential element of the cosmos itself. It is reuniting itself at every point, because no thing in the universe is separate from anything else. Everything is being united by that which is dimensionless at every dimensionless point. And so every single dimensionless point in the universe is right this moment, uniting everything in the universe. And then that is being radiated to all dimensionless points instantaneously. So it's a constant flow of recreative information, if you will, experience, perceptual understanding at the most fundamental level, at the most, like we are as large to the Planck non-local unit of action, 10 to the minus 34 centimeter, as we are tiny to the, in relationship and scale to this entire visible universe. Now, 10 to the minus 34 centimeter is not the last word here, because an infinitely short wavelength is most proximate, a single wavelength is most proximate to a dimensionless point. And according to the fact that the shorter the wavelength, the greater the energy, a cubic centimeter, as Einstein and David Bohm and many others since then have agreed, that even just a little thimbleful, a cup the size of the end of my pinky here, dipped into wavelengths of the Planck non-local unit of action, that 10 to the minus 34 a centimeter, that all electrons observe increments of when they are orbiting the atomic nucleus. Everything is, as Einstein showed in the photoelectric effect, everything, particles arrive in quantized increments of energy. So this amount of energy, this 10 to the minus 34 centimeter, just a cubic centimeter, like the end of my pinky here, of that wavelength alone, is an energetic equivalent of, if you took the energetic equivalent of every atom, which is a certain scale, 10 to the minus 17th, so there's 10 to the minus 17th relative to 10 to the minus 34th, all atoms at 10 to the minus 17th, and which there are, it's actually agreed upon that in every single grain of sand, there are more atoms, in every single grain of sand, more atoms than there are grains of sand and all the beaches of the earth. Check that out. So that the amount of energy in this cubic centimeter of 10 to the minus 34 centimeter, because it's a shorter wavelength, there's more energy in shorter wavelengths, that there's more energy in this single cubic centimeter, in this one, in this one, in this one, in this one, than there is in all, contained by all the atoms in the universe, nearly three times over. That is a lot of energy. And if you keep going down to a dimensionless point and to a single infinitely short wavelength, theoretically, that infinitely single, theoretically short wavelength is equal to infinite energy. Now that, of course, is just virtual. It's a potential. It's a virtual potential, potential and virtual or interchangeable words. And so we have out of nothing, out of what is dimensionless, out of a void, which is represented, which is boundless, has no beginning or end, has no edges, it's timeless, has no image of its own, has no energy, no locations in the world, but not of it, absolutely absolute and changeless. That absolutely dimensionless point has its closest neighbor being equal to infinite energy. Now, how can that be? Well, imagine that the whole of space, time, energy, and matter, mind and body, and all of its extensions over an infinite, endless, timeless existence becomes potential the moment there is an extension of that void and as taking up a position as bounded as a single dimensionless point in the context of what we relate to as space undergoing temporal clock time transformation. So that single dimensionless point is a localization of the non-local, that meaning the boundless, immeasurable, everywhere and nowhere. There really is no everywhere, there's just nowhere. Now it is somewhere at a distinct location. And so it is, now that it is bounded by space-time, it begins to undergo inflation in the form of many dimensionless points, having a certain discretion of being seemingly separate from each other in space over time. And so fields and forces build up between these points. And these points localize those fields and forces, spatial and temporal qualities that make them comparable and contrasting. And as mind and body begin to develop and flourish and evolve, it's also localizing what is sensed and felt and thought at every point. So it's all indivisible. And so there is more potential energy being localized at every point. And so the moment, the extraordinary thing is that the moment that space-time begins to manifest, the potential for an infinite number of years of its extension in space over clock time becomes potential or possible in quantum mechanics. And so from that very first moment of inception of the creation of the relative, the infinitely short wavelength represents this infinite potential energy, which then gives rise to this rapid fireball of intense heat emerging out of absolutely nothing whatsoever and coordinated by nothing, absolutely nothing whatsoever, which we are as well, and creates this visible universe. So imagine how easy it is to create universes. Now, there does seem to be the evidence for a multiverse, that there are the constant birth and death, collapse and re-expansion of universes of every imaginable kind and form, just like there are individuals that are each of us incomparably unique. We've never existed before and never will anyone will ever quite like us ever exist again. Our children are not like us, you know. We search for this sharing of, can anybody know what it's like to be me and share that and care about it and be empathetic with being nobody as everybody and nobody going everywhere and nowhere simultaneously. Can anybody share that with me, please? Because it's so weird and so wild and woolly and amazing wilderness that we all live here in nature. Nature is so perfectly orchestrated and flawlessly faithful in its life-giving properties, but it also deconstructs us and reconstructs us a trillion times a second. And so we are at the relative level, we're dying and being reborn, and ultimately we wear out, and then we die back into the whole, and then have a little, you know, respite where we, as formless non-physical consciousness, in between lives, we reflect on our lifetime as a human being, and we say, goodness gracious, look at all the craziness that I created unconsciously, and now I can digest this and prepare myself eventually to go back and give it another go at the level of form as a relative human being, or on maybe another planet or another, you know, as an extraterrestrial somewhere, and maybe as a plant or a bug or a leaf or a bunny rabbit or a dragon or whatever. And we can try out being different creatures with all the various sentient challenges that come along with that level of perspicacity. That ability to make and be responsible for what we're co-creating with all of creation. So I think that pretty much, lays it all out there in yet another way for you today, for us to share and contemplate and know and unknow and be mystified by and be overwhelmed and unconscious about together. So namaste, be the oneness in this one with the oneness in all those ones who ever watch this. Many kisses and all loving communion. I'll say bye for now.